right, good morning. Welcome to the training webinar. I'm Dale Franks. Today we are going to talk about something I have discussed before, although at this point it's over a year ago, and I'd like to revisit it, which is the subject of business value performance. There are many different ways in which a business value can extract data. We're going to take a look at that. I have a data set. We're going to walk through that data set and what I did to create the various means whereby we can query the same set of data and see how long it takes for each of the different types of data to return values in Process Director. I don't know what the answers are going to be because I didn't actually run the tests to see what the time was whenever I was prepping this again. I just sort of walked through to be sure that I had all of my data. So the results that we see today are going to be as much as of a surprise for me as they are for you. And I'm also interested in some of the performance improvements that we've put into the product. Now, I am running 6.1.109 on this particular version, which is the patch update that we released last week. I am not trying this on my more cutting-edge version of 6.1.300. There's some more improvements in terms of performance in that version than in .109, but 109 is the latest one that you could possibly have, so that is the one that we are going to use for our testing today. What we're looking at here is the base data. This is where I started off. I went to Mockaroo, and I generated 1,000 records of data. In this case, it just happens to be business names and addresses. We don't really care about the data per se itself, because the data itself is unimportant, other than we get an idea of what the size of our data is. I have 1,000 records here. That is intentional. And so we want to see what is it going to take to pull 1,000 records using a business value and using the various methods that are available to us to invoke a business value to return both external data and internal data. So let me go over the construction process that I implemented. Obviously, this is all going to be pre-built today. I'm not going to be building anything from scratch. I certainly considered it. I had the infrastructure built to do it, but I think it would probably take too long for me to rebuild all of this stuff from scratch live on the air and talk while I was doing it. So we're just going to look at the existing objects that I built based on this data. This data is obviously coming from Excel, so it was imported into Process Director, and I created a database table off of this. Apparently, my destination data source has been changed, but that's okay. The tables all exist in the system, and we'll be able to query them from the business values that I've created. So now that I have this basic data and I have it in the system, let's talk about business values themselves briefly. I have four different data types that I can run. In fact, this is the actual data that's imported into SQL. So this is my sample companies table. I apologize for the visual weirdness here, but I have the content list open and I have a smaller screen than usual because I wanted to have enough room for the timer that we're going to need a little bit later on, but I think I can at least make it slightly larger here on screen. But this is a SQL data source. When we're talking about data, especially for external data, it's generally the SQL data source that we use. We can also pull data from a knowledge view, of course. We're going to be demonstrating that a little bit later. So I need to be able to get this data into a knowledge view. We'll take a look at how I did that in a few moments. Then there are form instances. And we have the ability to take a given form definition and return a business value based on those form instances, which is, you know, obviously slightly different than the way that we would do it for a knowledge view. There is a reason for this. And by the way, I just want to be sure that, okay, yeah, I'm at the right size there. I just didn't know what the vertical screen area I had was in terms of what I'm sharing. So forgive me for that. But as I was saying, we have a couple of different ways of grabbing data from forms. Obviously, knowledge view is one, but knowledge views are complex because a knowledge view is designed to return basically any type of data from anywhere in Process Director. So the SQL that gets constructed whenever you build a knowledge view is actually quite complex. And for those of you who know SQL, it has many inner and outer joins associated with it. It largely gets created on the fly, but even the simplest knowledge view is a pretty complex bit of SQL when it gets passed to a database. And as a result of its complexity, there's a lot of recursion and multi-checking and multi-parsing that has to go into it. And so it is relatively expensive in terms of system resources. So if you only want to return form data and you don't really care about process data and all the other things that, you know, documents and definitions and all the other things that you might return with a knowledge view, then we have the form instances data source type where you can just select a specific form definition and just return its instances and the data associated with those instances, which should give us a performance improvement over a knowledge view simply because I'm looking at a smaller subset of the data. We're not going to discuss REST data sources. I'm not going to get into the business of timing how long it takes a REST data source to return data, largely because when you're looking at a REST data source, that's really something over which you have no control. The speed at which that data gets returned rests entirely on the application. It's based entirely on the amount of time the REST service takes to query and retrieve the data itself. I don't have a REST service. And even if I did have a REST service that pulled back these 1,000 records, which I certainly conceivably could have created, it wouldn't really matter because we don't really have any control over how quick a REST service works. REST services are often provided by, you know, public services. The data sources may be large, they may be small. We're not going to worry about REST. What we are going to worry about is those data sources that are inside Process Director over which we can exercise all of the control that we need to exercise in terms of how we are, what data we're looking at and how we're going to return that data. So we have this basic Excel data, which I have imported into the internal user database in which I can query from a SQL data source knowledge view. To get these other two types of knowledge views out, we're going to have to do a couple of little things. Obviously, I'm going to need this data not only as SQL table data, but I'm going to need it as form data as well. If I don't have form data for each of these results, then I can't really run either a knowledge view or a form instances data source as the basis of a business value. So I had a stream action set up. And with that stream action, I could just query that SQL table, and I could build and submit the form instances that I needed in the system. So I do have my 1,000 form instances. They do exist in the system. Obviously, I can't show all 1,000 in a knowledge view. This knowledge view is set like all knowledge views are by default to show only 100 records. So it's largely pulling the most recent 100. It pulls the records in the order in which it encounters them in the database. So it's not going to be a perfect replication of the last 100 records in the database. However, I've got my form instances. So now I have 1,000 form instances that I have been able to create. So based on just this data, I've got SQL data in the background. I've got form instances. I'm almost good to go to begin constructing tests for how this works. Unfortunately, it does get a little more complicated than that whenever we start building knowledge view data sources and what have you. For example, one of the things that I can do in a form is I can create a SQL view of that form, which will actually create a view in the process director, in this case, internal user database. And I have it here. It's called source data form view, where I can take all of these form fields and just create a view inside process director that contains all of my form instances. In addition, I also have the ability to cache my form data. So if we go to our homepage here, or our properties page for our form, note I've got enable form data cache set up. Well, that gives me actually three different data sources now that I have to look at, that I have to be able to query in a variety of ways. If I create a SQL view, that gives me another SQL-based business value that I'm going to have to run and test. If I enable the form cache, that's going to give me additional knowledge view options to query only this form cache table rather than query the entire process director database in a knowledge view. That should, at least conceptually, provide me with better performance. The trouble with a cache, of course, is that it's only as good as the last time it was updated. So if you have data with a high degree of currency, which in the case of a form instance would be many forms on a regular basis are submitted, but you're only recreating that cache, you know, once a week, then your newest data is going to be a week old. And if you renew that cache once a day, your closest data to current time is going to be, you know, up to a day old. So that doesn't really affect us in our current test case, because in this case, I've only got those 1,000 rows. It's the same 1,000 rows. So my cache is never going to change because the number of form instances I have is also never going to change. So being able to use a form cache in this particular instance for this testing does enable me to test apples to apples in terms of the data that I'm returning from my system. So with just one form, I now have three different methods of testing: one SQL, one knowledge view, and of course with form instance, well, webinar form instances, it just pulls all of the knowledge views. Let's actually take a look at the business values that we're creating. We'll just go through them one at a time as we reconstruct our testing here. We looked at this a few moments ago. This is our webinar SQL knowledge view. Now, this is actually going straight into the sample companies table. That is the table that I imported from Excel. So this is my SQL base data. And clearly, when I hit test query, that's pretty good. It's going to return 1,000 records to me. So I guess I'm pretty happy with that. The webinar SQL view for knowledge view, it's not a knowledge view, it's a business value. This business value, on the other hand, does query the source data form view. So we're still in SQL, we're still pulling SQL data, but now we are pulling the SQL data from the view that was created on the table. And again, if we hit test query here, it's going to run pretty quickly and pull my 1,000 records back. In our knowledge view, and we're going to have to look at both the knowledge views and both the business values. Well, actually, let's look at the knowledge views first. And let's look at companies plain. So this is a plain Jane knowledge view. It returns the source data form as the form associated with the knowledge view. On the options tab, I am only returning form instances. In my columns tab, I'm returning all of the data for that form. There's no filter or anything like this. It's plain vanilla. I just want the form data from that specific form instance. And I can go ahead and update that. And as you can see, it takes a little bit longer to run it. Now, here's a complicating factor that we have to discuss, which is how caching of UI elements works in Process Director. So when I create a form and I run that form for the first time, a cache has to be created. And as you can see, it took a couple of seconds to finally run this. And part of that, those seconds are what I'm discussing now, this caching issue. So when I'm going to present something to you in the UI, what Process Director needs to do is compile it. Now, once it's compiled, I can keep the cache of that object, whether it's, in this case, a knowledge view, whether it's a form instance. Okay, great. I've got that data. It is cached. And I don't have to worry about the amount of time that it takes to run a new instance of a form. For example, I'll show you what I'm talking about. I've got this webinar form template here, which is pre-built, and I don't think it has a set form data associated with it yet. It doesn't. There's no dropdowns. It just has some basic fields in it, which in this case happens to be an array. We'll see this array pretty quickly. So it doesn't return any data. It doesn't do anything. It's just a normal form. So we're going to time this. We're just going to hit run, and then I'm going to hit the timer real quick. We'll see how quick and accurate I can be. So save and run, hit our timer. And as you can see, the loading icon is loading there. And what's happening, of course, is that this form is being basically built and cached inside Process Director. So the first time I run this form, until that cache exists, there we go, we're at about 20 seconds. So it took about 20 seconds to cache this form. Now, from this point on, I'm a happy camper because I'm hitting save. So there's a couple of things going on here. I'm not just caching the form. I'm actually saving the form. I'm writing the form definition. I'm saving the form definition to the database. So doing it from here, probably not a great idea. That probably contributes greatly to why it is showing up as 21 seconds to go ahead and save this. So let's go back here. I should run it now, and I won't even have time to get to the timer to time this, because at this point, this form has been cached. And so when I create this form, it's going to be pretty much instantaneous now. And it's going to remain this way until that cache is removed. Now, unfortunately for me, the cache gets removed quite a lot because these are, you know, internal machines that every time we have an internal release gets updated, my other machine, the other process director server I use, gets updated really a lot. And every time that it's updated, all of those caches are gone and they all have to be recreated. That's a little inconvenient the very first time you run any form, having to recreate that cache. However, once the cache is created, you're good to go. And we can run that form and it just pops right open. Of course, this form doesn't actually do anything. So it's important before we do any of this testing that we ensure that we have run the cache on all of these forms, which I, by the way, did yesterday at about 5 p.m. I ran all the caches. What I'm trying to reduce is this amount of time here, the amount of time it takes to paint the form. I'm not going to be able to eliminate it completely because I do have 1,000 records of data, which means I'm going to have to put 1,000 records of data into what I think is going to be, well, I don't have to think. I can actually look at it. I can tell you how many fields are going to have to be painted on the form simply by looking at the edit tab. Given 1,000 records, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So I am going to need to paint 8,000 fields onto this form whenever it runs and it pulls data. Sure, this form runs quick. This form has no data. It doesn't do anything. And nothing is actually getting painted onto the screen because I have this section here that just, if there's no data, none of this gets painted. None of it exists. So, okay, that form will open quickly. There is going to be some element of time that is spent on painting those 1,000 records onto that form with their attendant 8,000 form fields. I think we have to make an assumption when we're doing testing like the testing that we're about to do, that it's largely going to take, irrespective of what form you use, it's largely going to take about the same amount of time to paint 8,000 fields on a form and display them. So we're going to discount that. And we're going to assume that any differences in performance we see are largely going to be based on differences of how long it takes me to grab that data out of the database. So as I run these initial knowledge views, it's going to take some time. And I'm going to run this one, but this one is a little bit different. Yes, its primary settings are the same. It's still looking for the source data form. It uses the exact, you know, returns, and it uses the exact same columns. The difference is here that, oh, wait, this is plain. That's not the one I wanted. I wanted this one. So again, same. I copied and pasted it. The difference, of course, is here on the configure tab, where I do have this property checked. This knowledge view will only use cached form instance data. So the data that I return, while it looks exactly the same as the plain knowledge view, is actually grabbing the data from a different source because I have run the cache and I have a cached table to look at rather than table form data. That is another thing that we have to keep in mind about the cache table and a regular knowledge view. Let me go up here. And actually, let me go in my data sources. Let me go into my internal user DB and let's take a look at the tables. And what I'm looking for is my cache tables, and I may not be able to see them here because this is an internal user data source. So let me switch over here. This is an internal DB data source, and I should be able to see them here. And in fact, I do. All of these table data lists. Okay, I gotta find them. They have specific names. And so, oh, there they are, way down there. Now, I don't know what tables these happen to be and which cache table is the one that we're looking at. But whenever we create a cache in the internal database, process director creates a special table that just returns the data from that cache. It actually takes the form data, removes it from its normal storage location, which is table form data, and creates one of these tables. You can always tell that you've got a cache table because it will always start off with the prefix TBL capital FDC, and then it will have some sort of, it's actually a part of a GUID that gets stored as the table name. So these are all of the cache tables that I have on the system. Because they are stored via GUID, I don't know what cache table is what. I just know that I have a cache table, and I know that I have a cache table for that particular form instance. So does Process Director. And even though I don't know which one it is, Process Director does know which one it is. So whenever I am looking for a cached data, and I click that text box, it is going to switch from what Process Director usually looks at to just one of those, whatever that table, it's table FDC underscore something. And that is the table that Process Director is going to look at. We should probably talk about the data structure in general whenever we have a form and we submit a form. So let me open up the documentation and we'll take a look at it. And in this case, I think we want to look at the database document. We want to look at two things. We'll want to look at table relationships, and we'll want to look at the table relationships for a form. Forms are complicated. You think, well, I'm just submitting a form instance, and that's all I have to worry about. Well, not so fast. Because there are other things you have to worry about, because that form, and this is the form ID of our form definition, well, that form is associated with a process timeline or conceivably a workflow, though I will tell you, none of you should be using workflow, but I do have those links. Table project is for a timeline definition. Table workflow is for a workflow definition. All of my form controls have their own table in which they are stored. So each one of these form controls are associated with this form. And well, we don't have any metadata here, so we don't have to worry about that. We don't have any document attachments, so we don't have to worry about table document. But I have table project in here twice, don't I? Huh. That's an oversight that I made when I was working in Visium. Sorry about that. In any event, I've got my table. I've got my table. Okay. I've got my form, rather. Then I've got my form instance. And from my form instance, I've got table form data. And table form data is a little tricky because table form data, if we go to our table definitions, table form data is the one table that stores every single value from every single form field from every instance in your installation. As you might imagine, table form data is large. It's very large. So based on the diagram we just saw, for me to pull table form data, I have this wealth of other information that I have to attach through from the instance to the form definition itself. And because I'm usually querying this table in a knowledge view, so even though I only want the data that is on a specific form, because of the way the data is stored, right? Every single field has its own record in table form data. So if I store a piece of, you know, one control with one piece of text on a form, I have to know, well, obviously, what's the primary key of the form instance? What is the primary, or what is the primary key of the form's control? So the data that I am storing has to come from a control. What control is it? So I've already got two things that I have to go out to external tables to find and confirm. The primary key in this table is actually a mixture of in array number and form instance ID. So every form control has an array number, even if it's not an array. If it's not an array, I think the array number is zero. And if it is in an array, the number is one. I think, if I remember correctly, that's why arrays are one-based, not zero-based, in process director. Though from a programming perspective, whenever we are doing programming stuff, like you're using a system variable, outside of process director arrays, everything else is zero-based, right? So if I want row number one in an array, I pick row number one. Okay, great. That has an array number. It is number one, because zero means it's not in an array, if I'm remembering correctly. Now I'm trying to get into the nuts and bolts of how the database works. However, once I have my control and I know the data, well, okay, let's say it's a string. All right, well, it's going to get stored in this field. But what if it's a number? Well, it gets stored in this field. What if it's a time or a date time? Well, it gets stored in that field. If it's a drop-down selection that I've made, well, I'm going to need the display string from that drop-down connection to be stored in this field. So based on the type of field that it is, I've got to store the field, its data type, and based on its data type, the actual value is going to get stored in one of those three columns in this table. And of course, there's an extra column, the display string, if it's going to be a drop-down control. And by the way, the display string is what a knowledge view will return by default rather than the value. So that gets a little tricky. The knowledge view actually returns both the value and the display string. We choose the display string to display in the knowledge view. Although, if you were to run the same SQL to pull the same data, you would actually have to specifically return the display string, because the value that actually got returned would be the well, in this case, I think it would be the usually it's a number value, so we'll just say it's stored in this field. It's difficult to describe to you how complicated this makes things, because every form field's value gets stored in the same table. I'm going to have millions of values in this table. I don't know from row to row until I actually store the value whether the value itself is going to get stored in S value, N value, or T value. I'll only know that based on the data type of that form. I don't know whether it has a display string until I evaluate the record. And of course, to figure out what is associated with all of this, I am back to my form. Okay, I just had it. There we go, right there. So now I'm back to these tables in the process directory database to determine where I'm pulling its relationship to the form, that form's relationship to the process timeline, actually the process timeline instance as well. It's complicated. A knowledge view has to query all of this stuff. Knowledge view has to figure all of this out. So the first thing it's got to do is chop through millions of rows that are in table form data, because every single form field value is stored there. And then for each row, it's got to go back and find all of this stuff to make all of the proper associations. So if I, in fact, want to know what the running activity name is, it's got to track through the project to the project instance. And I think even project instance or project user, a table project user instance. It's got a long way to go to figure out what data it is returning to me. There's a lot of joins here. Knowledge views are complex. So my normal knowledge view has to go through all of this to try to return data. So when you ask, you know, you guys always say knowledge views are slow and they place, you know, big knowledge use excessive system resources. Yeah, and this is why the database is hyper-normalized. So there's a whole bunch of links that have to be pulled and run through to grab associated data for every knowledge view that you run. So yes, knowledge views are expensive in terms of system resources. The plus side for that, the benefit that you get from that expense, of course, is that you don't have to know any of this stuff. You don't have to care about this. You don't have to care about table form value and what data it's stored and what field the value is stored. Why do you care? You don't need to. All you need to say is, give me this form, show me these fields, and make the magic happen when I click OK, and show me, well, I didn't mean to click OK. What I really probably should have done is just hit run. So when I hit run, make me happy and show me data. Don't make me work for it. Let me just pick stuff out of the UI. So the price you pay for that level of convenience to be able to just query anything in the system, anywhere that you want at any time, is a lot of complexity in the background. And so one of the reasons for caching the form data is simply to reduce that complexity, because everything that I really need should be inside of, you know, table form cache, and I should pull that. Now, that doesn't mean that all of the other sort of boilerplate SQL that exists in Process Director, that doesn't mean that it doesn't exist. Because even though now all I care about is table FDC underscore whatever the GUID is for that table, that table still has to be linked, right, to the project, the process timeline, or workflow. Please don't use workflow anymore for anything. It's the timeline instance, the timeline user instance. Those links all still exist. So using the cache table does save time, though, in the sense that I don't have to parse through 4 or 5 million records in table form data. Now I've only got to pour through the 1,000 records inside the cache table. That's great. Parsing through 1,000 records rather than 5, 6 million, 7 million, who knows how many million records are in table form data, but I don't have to care. I only have to care about the 1,000 rows that are in my cache table. I still have all of the other attendant burdens that accompany knowledge use. I've still got all these outer joins, but I don't have to parse through table form data. So that's where my time saving, theoretically, comes from with a cached knowledge view. And then there's my form instance, which is just all the form instances for this particular form. So now it's only pulling those form instances, and it's doing that via SQL. So let's take a look at what we've got here. I've got a normal knowledge view that pulls normal data. I've got a knowledge view that pulls cached data. I've got the form instances themselves that I can query via a business value. And then I've got two SQL business values that I can run. I can run the SQL view that gets created off of the form instances itself, or I can just run the base SQL that I originally imported into Process Director. So I've got five different business values that are looking at the same data, but organized in different places in the Process Director database in different ways. But I now have an apples to apples comparison. It's the same 1,000 records, same companies. Now we can see how we're going to pull that data. Now, the way that we pull that data is via a form. So we have already looked at that one form, which is a copy of this, no data. So we'll just look at one form, and the way that this form happens to be built largely is mirrored by all of the others. So basically, there is a set form data. I'm going to run this set form data on view state init. View state init runs one time when the form is opened. When you want to run your data is important in terms of application performance. I picked view state init intentionally because it's only going to run once the form is opened. Whether it's a brand new form or whether it's an existing form, view state init is going to run, and it's going to run once when the form is opened. There are many events that run on a form. We need to look at them just so that we understand the background. So let me go back into the documentation. I guess I probably should have stayed here. This time we'll go into the development. We'll go into custom scripting. We will look at our SDK classes, and we want the form class. And way down at the bottom of the form class, we have event types, and we're going to expand all of these different event types. Different events run at different times in the form's lifecycle. For example, if I am opening a brand new form has 10 different events that occur during the form opening process. If the form is an existing form, then it only has 8 events that gets run. Obviously, BP form initialize, since it's an existing form, the form doesn't have to be initialized. Form creation doesn't really run because, well, form creation runs because the form has to be created. On an existing form, of course, these two events just don't fire. But view state init does fire. There are other events that fire at various times, and there is an order of events in which things fire. So just let me give you a rundown on order of events. So let's say I click a task completion button or an OK button on a form. To close that form, 12 things are going to happen, and they happen in the order specified here. So if I have a custom task that depends on the result of some condition check that I run, this custom task is always going to fail. because it relies on an event that has not yet occurred. We sometimes get questions in support about, look, I'm trying to do this and it's not happening. Well, technically it is happening. It's just happening because you're trying to do it at the wrong time. And so you need to use the correct event to be sure that the other things that you are looking for have occurred, right? So, form completed is the last thing that happens. I find this often happens when an event is fired from a form control, right? Because there may be some, rules that they have that just don't run when they want a custom task to fire. Well, the custom task fires before the rules fires, or the custom task fires before form display. So if I have a change, I'm going to change a value on form display, and I also want to run a custom task based on the value of that form field, well, good luck with that, because the custom task is going to fire before the form display event. So if you are making something happen, setting form data on a form display event, okay, that's going to happen, but your custom task is going to fail, or at least it's going to run based on the old data because the data hasn't been changed yet, because display hasn't run yet. So the order of events that happen on a form are important. A lot of times people choose display for the event that they want to run to see data. That's not a great idea because the form display event fires a lot. It fires every time a new form or existing form is opened. It fires every time an event is fired from a form control. In fact, the only time it doesn't fire is whenever you are closing the form. So if there's any event that occurs, form display is going to happen. If you have a bunch of data that you are trying to pull on form display rather than, say, view state init for an existing form, you're going to be a super unhappy camper because every time a form event fires, in our case, we have 1,000 rows of data. And remember, we are filling 8,000 rows of form fields, or 1,000 rows of 8 form fields per row. So 8,000 form fields in an array to re-display that data. Your form is going to be a pain to work with because you've picked form display and form display runs all the time. Anytime any event fires, when a form is open, it's going to run form display. And if you have your data displayed on form display, I got bad news for you. That data is going to have to be requeried every time form display runs. The form is going to have to be repainted. You're not going to like your life as an end user setting it that way. Hence, I have used view state init to run all of my actions on my form to pull that data. So the only difference in these 5 forms, since the 6th form actually pulls no data, the only difference in these 5 forms is how I am grabbing the data. And so far we've looked at all 5 ways that I can grab the data off of this form, or out of the database, wherever it is. So now the only thing left for us to do is to run these bad boys and see how they work. Now, as I said, last thing I did yesterday is I ran all of these forms. So we're going to time them. And to make it easy for myself, I am going to unpin the content list. And I'm going to make this screen tiny little, tiny little. And I'm going to bring my clock way up here so that I am as close to the run button as possible. And we're going to start to run each of these forms. So we will hit run on this one. And I can't even get to the, control to do it. Actually, I think because the form may open in my way, I think what I want to do is I want to pull this way down here so that when the form instance opens, it doesn't open in the way of my stopwatch. All right, well, obviously that worked just fine. There was no form data to pull. All right, let us try now to run from our SQL table. So what I'm doing on this form is I am actually running it from the SQL table itself. So this is a the direct SQL query of the 1,000 rows that are in that table in the internal user database. So I'm just going to hit run and start. It's a good thing I moved it out of the way. That would have hidden my form. Oh, I stopped it too soon, didn't I? Okay, now I can stop it. All right, 15-ish seconds to pull this data. Now, again, remember, we're not just talking about the time it takes to pull this data. We're talking about the time it takes to pull this data plus the time it takes to write 8,000 records onto the screen and make them available to us in a single form. So all 1,000 of my records are here. We're happy with that. It did take 15 seconds to run it. How much of that was form painting and form creation? Because form painting is a pretty intensive effort when you have 1,000 rows and 8,000 form fields, even though I'm not actually displaying the form fields. I'm actually making it happen faster because I have all of these fields disabled, and I have show disabled fields as text. You know, I talk a lot about how I don't like to show users a form field that they can't actually edit. There are times when you do that, when you just say, hey, this field is locked, because you might need it as a visual cue for perhaps where you are in the process or what have you. But when I'm displaying data, I don't like to show users fields they can't edit. There is an additional consideration in that if I don't have to paint the form control, I can just grab the data and stick the data on the form as text without displaying the form control. That's going to be significantly faster. So I'm actually making this painting process go a lot faster simply by not showing the fields on the form by using show disabled fields as text. So I'm getting some performance improvement from that in terms of not having to paint those form controls. But we're at 15-ish seconds. Let's reset this since I kind of screwed up the timing on it. Let's run her again and see what we get. Well, I kind of screwed up the timing again because it took me so long to click the start button. 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Okay. So about 15 seconds. I think we can confirm that that's the amount of time it's going to take to run this one. All right. So 15 seconds from a SQL table. You know, while we're here, why don't we just record a couple of results here and there? We'll just do it in Excel. That way we can kind of see an amount of time. So we'll go with method and time. Method time? No, not what I wanted to do. Since we have some time, because this is not going to take 2 hours today, by the way, because I'm not trying to build this stuff out under pressure. So this is, we have plenty of time to do this. So SQL table and the time, we'll say 15 seconds. In fact, let's go with 0015. I'm doing that because I don't know whether or not we're going to see a time greater than 1 minute, but we're going to put it in as 0015. All right, great. So that's our SQL table. Now we have a SQL view. Again, we're still doing a SQL business value, but we are pulling it out of the view that I created from the SQL view tab of the form definition. So, in fact, let's call it form def SQL view. And this top one we'll just call plain SQL table. So let's run this second one, form results from a form SQL view. Let's reset our clock, run and go. So again, I'm querying SQL. So all things being equal, that's fine. But I am querying a view. And behind that view, by the way, there's a lot of other data that has to be brought in and imported. To make this happen, we're at about 17 seconds here. Technically, having seen the last bit of the repainting going on, I closed it a bit too early, but we're between 17 or 18 seconds. How reliable is that? Not sure. Let's check. Now, I think the last time I did this, and by the way, the last time I did this, which like I said, is several months ago, my times may have been substantially different. I don't remember. So I don't remember how long some of this stuff took. I do remember there was at one point something took 45 seconds to run. Now, we have had a couple of releases of the product and a fair amount of sort of background change, something that you're never going to notice on the foreground, but just some performance improvements built into the background. I think it might be interesting to go back and look at that previous version of this that I did and this one to see if there's any differences in time. All right, we said the first one ran in about 17 seconds, which pretty close. Let's run her again just for a sanity check. We're going to run each of these a couple of times just to try to see if we notice any unexpected variation in the amount of time it takes them to open. Okay, that one ran a little faster. That one was sub 15 seconds. So let's try her again, just to try to get a sense of what it is that we're dealing with. And if this is running sub 15 seconds, I'm kind of interested to see if we can get the SQL data view to run sub 15. Okay, I did this wrong. Duh, I didn't reset the clock. So we're going to have to do that one again. And okay, so around 15-ish seconds. This is really close to the regular SQL view one, which we'll run again just for confirmatory purposes. But I think I'm pretty happy here that we can look in the 15 second-ish range on both of these. Okay. That came in at 14-ish. Let's try that again. So there seems to be some slight difference in the time it takes, of course, given the variation of how long it takes me to hit the start button here. 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Okay, so 15-ish to 16-ish, but we've seen it as little as 13. You know, we're going to round this off, I think, right here at 15. And we're going to say that we have pretty equivalent performance running it from a plain SQL table or from the SQL view. Very good. I believe last time, there was a noticeable difference between these two, and now that difference appears to have disappeared. If I remember, there was an extra 3 or 4 seconds last time running the SQL view. So I'm interested to see that that appears to have been changed. All right, next is our K view, our regular plain knowledge view. So this is just a plain K view that is going to be running out those 1,000 records. Let me reset my timer. K view plain, task number 3, run. And let's see how long this takes to pull those 1,000 rows and then paint them on the form. All right, we're coming up on 15. Oh, now it's getting slower. Now we're seeing a significant performance difference. 24 seconds. That is substantially slower than the business value. Again, we're having to paint. I don't know how much time painting those 8,000 records takes. I don't know. So we can only assume that it takes a similar amount of time. And we're going to run this again, by the way, while I talk. We're going to assume that it takes a stop. I didn't click the start button. So we're going to assume it takes a similar amount of time to do that painting. So what we're really interested in then is the delta in times from each different method. And so we can calculate that kind of in our head. Okay, 23, 24, come on, paint. All right, we have 25 seconds. So the other time it was around 24 seconds. Now we're at 25 seconds. Let's do one more just to confirm. And we'll run for another 25 seconds. But that, at 25 seconds-ish, 24, 25 seconds, that is a 9 or 10 second delta between the time it takes to pull something directly from SQL, even using a SQL view, and the amount of time it takes to use a knowledge view. Okay, 21.57. That's better. Let's give her one more try. Messed that up. Got to be really precise for hitting these buttons. So we're going to run it again. It doesn't really matter. I am over 20 seconds in each time. The fastest I've run it is 21. Now, there is going to be some natural variation. Obviously, how busy your system is, what your SQL server is doing in the background. Things may be slightly faster or slightly slower from attempt to attempt, but you know, once again, we're back at about 25 seconds for just running a plain K view. So fine, we'll go with, well, not 0000. So 25-ish. So there we go. We have now a 10-second delta, and we'll just type in delta right there. In fact, let's make it pretty or slightly prettier. Let's boldface that. In fact, let's make it bigger so that you can read it out there. All right, so I've got a 10-second delta on a plain K view and normal SQL. Great. Then let's run a cached K view. So we're running the K view now against the data that is cached in that cache table rather than running it against the entire process director database. Let's see what this looks like when we run it. Again, we're going to run it a couple of times just to try to get a sense on average of how long it's going to take. Obviously, if I really wanted to run an average, I would run this, 20 or 30 times, and I would calculate an average off of a you know, N equals 30 run, and then we'd have a much more likely average. Oh, now that's nice. That's 18 seconds on that one. So that is a much smaller delta than we saw with a normal knowledge U. Oh, no, I messed it all up. Got to hit the button. And you got to be precise when you hit the button. So there's also the delta of me fumbling around with the stopwatch button. Maybe it would help if I moved the stopwatch up higher so that the button was closer to the run button. 16, 17, yeah, 17, 18, 19, okay. Took 20 or 21, so there's a little variation there. Again, as I said, we kind of have to expect some variation between what your database happens to be doing on the background, whether there's any maintenance running, whether other queries are being run on the system. If you have multiple databases on the system, you know, how much power is being used for those other databases. Okay, that was 18. So it looks like between 17 and 18 on this, which is actually a significant improvement over a regular knowledge U. We're going to run it one more time just to confirm that we're in the 17 or 18 second range here. Well, it took us 20 seconds that time. All right, so it has taken us between 17 and 20 seconds. So there is some slight variation. Again, not sure how much of that is caused by form painting, but let's go with 18 as just a guess. So our cache data, I'm writing in Russian now. Cached data. Okay, C-A-C-H-E-D. Cached data cave view. We're going to generously give this 18-ish seconds. Because I got a 17, two 18s, and really two 20s. So I'm going to stick with 18, I think. I know it's rather arbitrary, but we're going to go with 18, which actually over SQL gives us a much better 3-second delta off of our SQL. So that's pretty cool. Now we will go back to our form instances business value. That is just pulling the form instances directly in the BV. So let's run that a couple of times. Oh, it is easier when there's less distance to travel to click the button. I will say that. So is this going to be sub 18? It is not going to be sub 18. We're going to throw this one out. And the reason we're going to throw this one out is I think this is caching in the background and other things are happening besides running the form. So we're going to toss this because 40 seconds seems like a long, long time. Yeah, I reject that this is taking a minute to do. I do not think it should take that amount of time. So we are definitely, we're just gonna stop this because that's ridiculous. That was a minute and 10, 12 seconds. I'm gonna assume that this was not cached and that maybe I just missed creating the cache for this form, or maybe I opened it and made some infinitesimal change that caused the cache to be invalid. So let's try this again. Now that we've run the form, it should be cached. We should get a more reliable number now. And if it still runs at a minute and 7 seconds, then I am not going to recommend that we use that type of business value to return form data, because that seems excessive. In fact, once I hit 17, I'm going to be unhappy with this method of pulling the data. I am now super unhappy with this method of pulling the data, because now we are going far, far longer than we should, which I guess is great to see this live, because at least it lets me know what the next JIRA ticket that I'm going to be submitting to the engineering team is going to be. So this looks like a real time. Now, minute and 10 seconds. That seems excessive. I'm not sure why this would take that long to run. Still painting. All right, that got us to a minute 9. So minute 10-ish looks like what we are running here. Now, just to be sure, let's check what we're doing here. All right, it is webinar form instances. We are putting the regular stuff in there. Okay, that's the form. I don't want to save it, but I do want to go back over here to my form instance, webinar form instances. That is the knowledge view. Let's test the form conditions. Okay, 1,000 form instances match the specified condition. Great. Well, it knows what my form instances are. It knows where they are. This appears to be doing what it is supposed to be doing. So if we go back over here to types and we make this smaller, we're going to do this one more time. And it looks like a minute 10 is our number for form instance. I will tell you that I am substantially disappointed to see this result. So as I said when we started, the results that we see today are going to be as new to me as they are new to you. Now, there is a significant difference between what we saw a year ago before the performance improvements and what we are seeing now in terms of both knowledge views. Well, the SQL, it didn't really change much. SQL is SQL. That really is kind of dependent on the database, isn't it? But the knowledge views have been substantially increased in performance. I think the last time we ran this, we were seeing 30 to 45 second times for knowledge views, super long for those knowledge views. And it looks like we have cut the delta between knowledge views and SQL substantially. Again, both of these will be on YouTube, so we can actually look and see, we can compare. I was about to say, I'm going to compare, but I'm not entirely sure I'm going to do that because I'm not sure I have the time to do that. So this one went a lot longer. This one took 117, but again, I also opened up the form, so I'm going to assume that 7 seconds of that at least were caching time. So we're looking at, let's just do it one more time. Again, it's only 11:14. We have another 45 minutes, technically. But I think this is the last time we're gonna run this. Because 117 was a little long. I'm thinking that there may have been some form caching issues so that the cache needed to be recreated. So I want to eliminate that as a source of variance, although, you know, this is really just an ad hoc test. It's not in any way scientifically or statistically rigorous. However, just in terms of fairness, but I think a minute 10 is probably what we're looking at. But let's confirm that, because that 117, 7 seconds is a pretty big delta. That seems like a pretty big outlier. So let's just run her again and see if we can get back to that 109, 110-ish. I think our first one ran actually at 107. Well, they were at 107, 8, 9, 10. No sign of a form yet. Ooh, this is taking longer and longer. All right, 117. So we're between 107 and 117. That's a big variance. I'm not sure what would cause a 10-second variance. One or two, I might, you know, might blow off as something extra is happening on the database. Somebody else is using a lot of it, but 10-second delta, So form instance BV is awful. I was hoping I would not have to write these numbers, but here we are, 01, and let's split the difference. Let's call it 112. Not that it matters, because again, we're at a 57-second variance between the three methods that we're using here. So there we go. Those are the results of our brief testing of the different ways that we can look at essentially the same data, although it comes in different forms. And considering that I think last time we were looking at over 30 seconds or 30 seconds plus for a knowledge view, cutting 5 seconds off of that, I think is pretty good. Now, how much of this time again is form painting? It could be as much as 15 or 16 seconds because the actual knowledge views run pretty quickly. So we don't know how much time is spent form painting because there is the data piece in there, but we can look at how long it takes each of the knowledge views to run and to return data. So this is what it looks like from the form. So let's add another typology here. Oh, it's capitalized it for me. So in this case, we're all running everything via a form. So let's just fill that down to form. Let's run her again. And now I'm really curious about something. Because I've run it off of a form. Okay, I get that that's a form. Fine. What happens if we just run the knowledge use? Can we time those knowledge view runs? So I'm still not seeing all of my, where's all of my pretty conditional formatting? All right, well, fine. I'll make up some colors. So let's go our form stuff there. And this, we're just going to go with BV, and we're going to run the BVs themselves. And we're going to paint that background color with a nice blue. So let's run through and see what our differences are just running the knowledge views themselves. Now, with the caveat that I'm not going to be able to time it if we run it from the knowledge views or from the business values, but let's just run the business values themselves. So in the SQL folder, those are my two business values. So this is the webinar SQL business value. And I just want to hit SQL data source. I just want to hit test query, and we'll see how long it takes to drop our data in here. I guess I can actually make this wide enough so that we can all see it. I don't think that I'm going to be able to hit the timer button, but we're going to try. 1001. Okay. I can't hit the timer buzzer. It was 3/4 of a second ish. 1001, 1002. Okay. Well, that took a long time. When was that taking so long? 1000. Okay. Well, that went really fast. Okay. Less than a second. I'm looking at how long the thing shows up. So 1001. Okay. Half a second. 0.05 second. That's how long it takes to run that query and return the data. So we'll just go with 0000. Five. That's a pretty quick run. It's always going to be faster, by the way, doing this, since we don't have to wait for the form to get painted. So here is my query from the SQL view. We will test that query. 1000. Okay. I can't even get to 1001. So again, we're just going to assume that we have more or less the same performance here. It's taking me about a half second to grab that data. So let's go back to our plain knowledge view. Navigate up. We'll go into K-View and we'll run our plain knowledge view. Now this I should be able to time. So, okay. I can't just run it from here. All right. Weird. Thought I could. So, oh, that's a business value. Obviously I can't run it from there. This I can run from here. And once again, let's make things tiny here so that my distance isn't that far. And knowledge view is running. Okay, well, just in terms of the knowledge view running, that's... significantly slow. All right, that got us 19 seconds is what I saw. We'll go back. Let's run it one more time. We'll reset. I didn't hit the stop button fast enough. Run. So running on the form, the first time we ran it through was 25 seconds. Running it from the knowledge view was 19 seconds. So that gives us about a 6-second delta between showing it on the form and running it as a knowledge view. Okay. Took me a second to hit the button. Again, we're at about 18 seconds for this knowledge view to run. So our plain K view is running in 18. And that's obviously a big delta, a much bigger delta. But again, this all has to be painted on the screen. All of our knowledge view information has to be painted on the screen. So I can't really compare it to running the SQL view. I can compare it to running the form because both have to be shown on screen. Both have to be painted. And I am still... my delta between the plain K view at the top is a good 7 seconds. So seven seconds from row 4. So we'll assume that these two are linked. So actually, this is not 7 seconds. This is minus 7 seconds from running it in the form. Well, not what I wanted to do. Minus. Okay, it's not. Fine. Okay, fine. Here's your stupid apostrophe, Excel. Now it says -7 seconds. Let's look at our cached data KView. Run that bad boy. So this is the cached version of the knowledge view. We'll be sure that that's the only thing that's checked. Reset our stopwatch and we'll run the cached version. So plain KView ran 18 seconds. Now we did see a substantial, we saw a 3 second. Okay, 14, almost 15 on this one. So again, we're back to about a 3 second delta in terms of how long it takes to produce the cached KView as opposed to the regular KView. So we're going from 18 to 15-ish, slightly under 15. So let's call it a 4.5 second delta at this point. Let's see if we can get her back in that sub 15 time. Well, we got to 16 on that one. Let's try her one more time. Oh, I went a little too far there. Well, I didn't hit run clearly. So it was 14 and a half to about 16 and a half. There was about a 2 second delta on those two runs. On a third run, we're back to 14, and that was a good solid 14. So substantially less than the top where it ran 25. So at 14. Actually, let's just call it 15 to round it out because we did see a 16 there. So compared to what we had at the top for the cached data KView, again, we're still 3 seconds less just running it off of there. Put my apostrophe in, -3 sec. Okay. And so now let's run that form instance business value and see what the deal is with that. So we'll go to form instances. We're going to have to make this big again so that we can actually see the business value. All right, let's see what we're looking at in terms of time here. That is a long way for me to stretch to get that start button. Let's reverse it just to make it easy for me. That was the wrong thing, clearly. Sorry. Clear. We need to test form conditions. This, I think, is going to be unreasonably quick. And I'll tell you why it's going to be unreasonably quick. Because it's not returning any data. So this is not going to tell us anything. It's just going to say that there's 1,000 form instances that match the specified condition. It's basically just going to return the number of form instances. It's not going to go out and actually query the data. So in this particular instance, doing it from the base object is not going to be super helpful. So unfortunately, that's as good as we can get here. So the only real way to test that is in a form. And that's not good. 1:12. That is super, super slow. So I'm certainly going to be talking to the engineering team about this and having them take a look at it, because we have managed to do a fair amount of performance improvement on the system in terms of the operation of KView over the past year. That's a good thing. We clearly want that to continue. I would point out, however, that in terms of time, if I have form data and I want to place that form data on a form, let's say I'm doing some reporting, And this would certainly be true if I was using a report object, because you can't even use a business value for a report. You have to use either a SQL value or a knowledge view. So in that case, you have to use a knowledge view. But if I am just going to grab data and put it on a form, and I'm really interested in convenience, and I might want to fill out a fair amount of data, if I have form instance data, then probably the most efficient method for me to pull that data is to create a form SQL view for that form and to pull that data from a form in a business value, to use that business value to pull it from the SQL view. As far as I can tell, that is the most efficient way of grabbing not just a large amount of data, really any amount of data, because the principles apply across the size of the data that you're pulling. If I'm pulling data and I want to display it on a form, my most efficient method is to pull it from a SQL view made from the form definition. That way I have the power of SQL going through and parsing my data. I am not mediating that SQL via a knowledge view. That's, the other problem with a knowledge view when it comes to just the pure grabbing of data. One of the prices that you pay is that there is this UI, which has its own properties, methods, and events that is interposed between you and the data. So not only is it a complex UI and it complexifies the data that you're returning, but I've just got this UI wall between me and the data. And that has a time penalty placed on it as well. As I said earlier, the penalty you pay for ease of use in a knowledge view, not having to know SQL, not having to care about it, the penalty you place is that somebody has to know SQL and somebody has to care about it, and the SQL has to work. If you're not going to do it, then fine. And maybe you don't know how to use SQL, and that's perfectly okay. But you're going to pay that efficiency price in having a UI and additional complexity that's interposed between you and the data. So getting rid of that intervening object and going straight to a data SQL view and pulling that data seems to be your fastest method of getting that data and painting it on a form. Now, remember, these numbers are big intentionally because I'm pulling and painting 1,000 rows of data. Please don't put 1,000 rows of data in an array on your form, because it's going to be slow and it's going to be tedious. However, we can do it. And the reason that I went with 1,000 rows of data is I wanted to have a bunch of data. I wanted to have 1,000 rows plus of data so that we could actually see some time differences. If I tried to do this with 5 rows of data, we might not notice some difference. I needed to process a fairly large data set. So based on what we have here, form definition SQL view seems to be your quickest and most efficient bet for grabbing just form data from the database and displaying it on a form. Now, the nice thing about the form def SQL view is that you get to use a SQL data source, and the SQL data source just takes your SQL and pushes it straight through. And the inconvenience, of course, is that you have to use a SQL data source, and if you don't know SQL, that's obviously a burden that you might not want to have imposed on you. But this is our SQL data source. It's pretty simple because I'm just selecting everything and I'm ordering it by company, and it's returning all the data, and it's returning it to me super fast, largely because the view is already compiled on the server. So it just runs and pulls my data for me. So that seems to be the official results of our testing today. That testing has now been completed, and since that is so, so has this training webinar. Have a great week. I will look forward to speaking with you at the next webinar next week. Until then, so long.